I could scarcely imagine that it would ever be possible to print out the whole of one genome in a book. But today, the process has been so speeded up that it's possible for anyone to have it done in half a day. And the comparison between the genome of one species and another has proved very revealing. The hot chemical springs of Yellowstone contain the very simplest form of life, single-celled bacteria, about as far removed from our complex selves as any organism could be. But we share some 200 of our genes with those very early life forms. Indeed, there are some genes that are common to every single species of life. Our DNA extends in an unbroken chain right to the beginning of life, 4,000 million years ago. So now we can trace our evolutionary heritage back through geological time, back to the age of dinosaurs, and further still to the early amphibians. Back to the fish. And the first backbone animals. And further still, to the single-celled organisms that were the very earliest form of life to appear on this planet. So, in my lifetime, science has solved many of the riddles which 60 years ago seemed so baffling. How mountain ranges are formed, why animals are distributed in the way they are, and how they communicate with one another. How a complex chemical molecule can transfer the characteristics of one generation to the next. It's even shed some light on that deepest of mysteries as any origin of life. So now, the natural world makes more sense than it ever did, which is why studying it is so rewarding and so delightful.
To project that state of affairs back in time as if it had always existed. It hasn't always existed. This has gradually come to be the way it is. So the story of America usually starts here with the Scopes tribe. Usually it's called the Scopes Monkey tribe. In 1925. This is another one of those famous episodes, a bit like the Huxley-Wilberforce debate, which is it's blown all up proportion into a legendary account, which isn't really true. In fact, the truth of this case is actually much more mundane. In essence, the state of Tennessee, had banned the teaching, not just of evolution, but the doctrine that human beings were descended from anything else. Now, this is problematic in America because they're not supposed to advance, support, or indoctrinate, or teach any religion in state-funded schools. You can do that in a private religious school, but that's fine, but not in state. So the American Civil Liberties Union wanted to take this case up because it had been, this teaching of evolution had been outlawed in this state, and so they wanted to contest it as a way of generating publicity about it, and also they got the way to getting that law repealed. And so, according to the usual story, a biology teacher named Scopes taught evolution in his class and was charged with breaking the law and was taken to court as well. The real story behind this is, in fact, that he wasn't a biology teacher. He was asked by representatives of the town of Dayton if he would do this. It was a show trial. They did it just to get publicity for their town. And it worked amazingly well. It became the most widely publicized trial in history. It was the first trial ever to be broadcast live. Of course, in those days it was radio, not internet, I think. And it boiled down to the personality types of the two main legal representatives. I strongly encourage you to read the suggested reading for today's lecture, which is on IVLB. It's only one or two chapters, but they're really short. And it's all about the Scopes Monkey Trial, and in addition to other things that are based in this lecture. Anyway, so the trial was a show trial. It was vastly publicized all over America. So the issue that is still alive today is sort of born then, that you had extremely animated opponents of evolution who didn't really know what it was about, who didn't understand it, but knew that they really hated it. And then you had a few members of the scientific community or from, from the American Civil Liberties Union opposing them, saying that, you know, what they're trying to teach is an old-fashioned theology that doesn't have any place in the science classroom. Because they're trying to teach the doctrine of creation as it's given in the Bible, and that's religion, not science. But Scopes was, well, anyway, the first thing that happened, of course, is the famous debate, which you can see on the movie poster, because a play was later written about the Scopes trial called Inherit the Wind, and that was then later made into a movie, Spencer Tracy play. The most famous confrontation, I think that people remember, is that the William Jennings Bryan, who's the man on the top right, famously took to the witness stand. He was the chief prosecutor, and was grilled by the chief defendant, Clarence Darrow. And Darrow asked Brian a series of questions, like, how long are the days mentioned in the book of Genesis? Are they 24 hours long? Or there's some other period? Right, well, I'm not so sure, but I think they're a day. Well, what about these days before the sun and the moon were created? Were they a day without any light? Again, Brian didn't really know. How old is the world? Brian, well, I'm not really sure, but he basically admitted that the periods, that the days might actually mean periods. So perhaps they were six periods of time added up to the creation of the world and so forth. The bottom line of this, although Brian ended up looking like a fool in front of the world press, and a few days after the trial, he died. Maybe not connected, or maybe he was extremely stressed by the experience of being made to look like a fool, because he didn't know what he was talking about when he was asked questions about science and so forth. But what he had admitted was that he was interpreting the Bible. And therefore, the people that were that he represented, who wanted to say that, no, we're not interpreting it at all, this is the literal truth. There's no interpretation involved, so there's only one correct view. But of course, their chief representative admitted that, well, this was his interpretation of what the text meant. Well, if it was okay for him to interpret what it meant, then why isn't it okay for everyone else to interpret what it meant? And if you open that up, then some interpretations are entirely consistent with Darwin evolution. End of the conflict. Or it would be, if everyone would agree to being so open on their freedom of interpretation. Anyway, so this was the first trial of its kind, and there have been several of them since then. And they're all remarkably similar. Some American state bans the teaching of evolution in their public schools. It then later gets challenged. There's a big trial against those publicity, and usually they get taken down. But Scholes was found guilty because he really did teach evolution in his capacity. But he was fined at $5, and it was just nothing serious. And it was later overturned on a technicality anyway. Okay. So, as I've emphasized in this course about evolution and its place in the scientific community, yeah, we know since the 1870s it's just been part of science. After the Scopes monkey trial, a whole new brand of American Christianity emerged, which is often referred to as Christian fundamentalism. Although nowadays the word fundamentalist has come to be sort of a dirty word. I don't think no one would call themselves that anymore. They'd probably call themselves, I don't know, evangelicals or whatever, church they belong to. Anyway, so what has happened is there have been a series of attempts to get this American-specific brand of creationism into the public schools, into the science classroom, to counteract what many parents and church leaders thought was an unfair case in which their children were being indoctrinated in the science classroom with something that their parents didn't like, that they objected to. And this seemed unfair. How come the evolution gets taught to their children, but their children cannot be taught the kind of creationist views that the parents espouse? And so it's happening again and again. So in the 1970s, it was called creationism, and after the big court case in that time, it was thrown out. So the creationists went back to the drawing board and relabeled their doctrines to include the word science. They either used the word creation science or other versions with science and creationism stuck together, claiming this time, okay, we're not trying to introduce religion into the science classroom. This is science. It's the science of creation. So it's just our science versus their science. So it cannot be cast out as rejected as religion. Well, this also ultimately failed after there were more test trials and so forth. And it was successfully argued that this was exactly the same as the creationism that had been published and promoted in previous decades, with just a different name. And surprisingly, the same thing happened again. Most recently, the creation science camp has been relabeled intelligent design. That is also supposed to be a science. Therefore, it belongs in scientific classrooms, and it's not a religion, and so forth. And the trial, this is, I think this is the most recent one, the trial over that one, they were devastatingly refuted by the scientists and the other experts they had. They even were able to demonstrate through, I'm not sure exactly how they did this, through some, I think they had acquired some sort of digital files from the creation, sorry, the intelligent design publishers. And they found in these electronic files that they had actually taken some of their earlier books and just done a global replace every time it said creation science and put in intelligent design. But in a few cases, this made words that didn't make sense. And they found these files and showed them during the trial. They said, look, we are arguing it's the same doctor with a different name. Here's proof. And that's pretty good proof when you use global replace. So it was the same doctrine. And so again, it was thrown out. But this is still the one I would say that has been a new name since that. So intelligent design is still something that is talked about well, mostly in America, but not exclusively, and it's still bouncing around the internet. It's often abbreviated as ID. People who talk about this so much, they need abbreviations. Oh, you're Singaporeans, you love abbreviations. Everything in Singapore is abbreviated. I sometimes, my head is spinning when I hear all these letters. I can't understand what enough people are talking about. But I'm slowly getting used to it. Anyway, so ID, you should all love that. ID. CS, ID, anyway. So I'll now talk about some of the specifics. The amazing thing about this intelligent design, let's call it a school, or a school of thought, as it were, is that it's re-evoking the arguments of Paley, which a few people recognize this because Paley is famous for being the design argument man. What they're not aware of, and which you are, is that, of course, Paley, what did not originate this argument, was already really, really old when Paley published his book in 1802. But anyway, the argument, remember, was that, look, living things fit together so well, they're so well adapted to the world, that they look designed. They look like something designed into the depth. You know, my hand looks like it was designed to pick things up or whatever. The eye looks like it was designed to see, and so forth. Darwin, in his autobiography, by the way, I should have pulled this quote out for you, he notes the old argument from design of Paley. Is refuted now that the law of natural selection has been discovered. And it goes on and on to talk about that. Which I think most scientists wouldn't have accepted that in Darwin's day. But anyway, that is the argument that this school of thought, which is, I suppose, now still the most widely spread creationist sort of school of thinking around nowadays, is that living things have some evidence in them that they were divinely designed. The thing that the intelligent design people do to not appear like they're preaching a religion, which then they wouldn't allow them to get into public schools, is that they say, well, we don't know who the designer is. We see evidence of design in living things that just tells us that it's the God of Christianity. So we're not pushing Christianity. It's science. That's their argument. That's their claim. Okay, here's one of their most popular arguments. It's called irreducible complexity. It's the argument by a biochemist named Michael Behe, who is an American Catholic, I believe. His book is called Darwin's Black Box. In it, he argues that there are certain microscopic organisms like these, which have a flagellum, which is like a little tail, that repels them. And that every part of this structure must be present for the flagellum to repel, to work. If you took any one piece away, it will fail to work. Therefore, Dee argued, it could not have evolved through gradual steps, because any series of flagellums that were not complete would be useless, so it argued. And this has encouraged many people, because it sounds convincing. Ah, yes, well, that seems to make sense. If anyone could part was taken out, it wouldn't work. And so it must have been designed and created all at once. So this must be such evidence. He uses the analogy of a mousetrap to make it more intelligible, because the microstructures of tiny organisms are a bit abstruse for most of us, including me. But mousetrap is simple enough that we can all understand. Take away any one piece, and it doesn't work. Therefore, it must have been designed. And I don't know if Beaky still makes this argument, it's been quite a long time now, but his critics have very thoroughly refuted his claims. For example, it's not true that there are no halfway points to this kind of flagellum that spins in a particular way. In fact, there are many, many versions, which were quoted by one of his critics, showing structures that do contain only parts of these in fully functional organisms. And so that the claim that it could not evolve gradually is weakened. Ah, but what's the most important thing is that for you as a reader or as a listener, encountering an argument like that, I hope that you would recognize what kind of argument it is. That's the kind of thing that you can, you know, that's transferable, as university jargon would probably call it. In other words, you can use it anywhere. What you should, I hope, recognize in this argument is that it is a logical fallacy called the argument from ignorance. Let me rephrase it and then it will become clearer. I cannot see how this structure could have gradually evolved. Therefore, it could not have gradually evolved. That's called the argument from ignorance. So no matter what someone is talking about, if they make an argument of that structure, it's a fallacy. And these are happening all the time all around us, particularly in popular culture. And it also turns out that he's wrong about the mousetrap. The mousetrap, too, has evolved from a long series of simpler gadgets which had only parts of these functions. Apparently, as far as I'm aware, this kind of mousetrap goes back to a certain kind of fishhook that had spring on it. And that was a later change into another kind of trap with another piece added, and that kind of trap was added. Taken into a new trap design, which had another piece added, and so forth. So in fact, there are a whole series of intermediate traps that evolved into the modern mousetrap. So his example, which is also incorrect, but it's something that has gradually come to be. Okay, the other kind of argument that these modern opponents of evolution like to bring out are what is another logical fallacy called appeal to the consequences. In other words, that if you teach evolution or you accept evolution, bad things will happen. So it will lead to immoral behavior, or if people are taught that they're animals, they will behave like animals. Those are not my words, that's just a very common quotation that one sees. What's wrong with that one? Why is that a logical fallacy? Because the question of whether or not the thing is true is irrelevant to what its consequences may be. The consequences might actually all be completely true. Accepting evolution, maybe it would lead you to be a horrible, immoral monster and want to eat babies and do horrible things. Or anything might make you behave like an animal, or whatever. But would that affect whether or not it was true? No. It's a reason why you don't want people to believe it. But it's not an argument about whether it's true. So such things are, sadly, a waste of time. Because they don't actually touch on the veracity of the things in question. But anyway, it's a very, very popular argument, and you can do 5 minutes of Googling to come up with loads of examples of this. So, here is one of the historical examples that people use in this sense. The eugenics movement. Have you all heard of this? Eugenics? It usually gets a mention in courses about evolution or biology or whatever. Eugenics was a movement founded by Darwin's cousin, Francis Galton. Remember, we saw him in the lecture about Mendel. Remember, he's the one who transfused the bunny blood. Big man. Okay. He was rather obsessed with heredity in humans. And he started this movement, which is now known as eugenics. There's various kinds, as always. There were some very benign versions of eugenics. There were also pretty nasty versions of eugenics. They wanted to improve humanity by good breeding. In other words, okay, there's two main types of this. One is you want to get the right sort of people to breed more, so we get more right people, and maybe the population gets better, maybe smarter or healthier or something. This might sound a little familiar to you if you're from Singapore. I'm not joking, it is. You are all be bombarded with the alumni packs tempting you to social events where they hope you will hit off with each other and make more interest graduates. Really? In fact, they probably started on you already. So that's the more benign version. The nastier version is to get rid of or stop the supposedly inferior from breeding, from reproducing. And one version of that would be, say, not to give marriage licenses to people who have birth defects or who are retarded or who are considered undesirable, who are criminals, who are alcoholics, who are have other problems that society wants to have less of. Nastier versions would be preventing them from reproducing, for example, by sterilization. And this, in fact, went on in many countries for many decades, including the USA, where people were sterilized for many years if they had certain conditions or if they came from certain groups. Anyway, now, there is some slight connection between this eugenics and the thinking of the Nazis in Germany, but it's rather indirect, and I'll get to that when I show you the next slide. Anyway, the point of this is that eugenics nowadays is considered by everyone to be not very nice, or basically evil. It's bad. It's a bad thing. No one would stand up for eugenics anymore. Well, that's obviously not true. But no one would use the word anyway, because it's generally considered to have been a big mistake and so forth. And proponents of evolution like to say that this is a direct consequence of evolution, this kind of thinking and so forth. And therefore, to try and tarnish its name or image by saying, look at what it results in teaching people about evolution. They will believe crazy things like this and behave in a way that's not very nice. Similarly, the catastrophe of the First World War was attributed to Darwinism, because it had existed before the war, and so the war was supposedly the result of people being Darwinians. I find this argument really bizarre, because people have been having wars forever, in which we've always been unbelievably nasty to each other and kill each other in horrible ways, and we're still doing it. But anyway, that's one of these appeals to the consequences. And then, of course, the Holocaust in Germany in the Second World War. And there are several books, some of them very recent, which try very hard to connect Darwin to the Holocaust, to connect Darwin to Hitler. But the authors of these books, in all cases that I've met one of them, they are all should I say, they're personal critics of evolution. They are sympathetic or indeed exponents of intelligent design or other versions of creationism, and their work is explicitly trying to blacken the name of Darwin and of evolution and so forth by this kind of appeal. In fact, Hitler never read Darwin. He read a few superficial pamphlets by people who may have read someone, who may have read someone, who may have read Darwin. I mean, there's just no direct connection. Hitler, argued that the German people were a superior race, and the so-called Aryan race, and that they wanted to improve Germany by getting rid of inferior races, particularly the Jews, because for some reason they hated Jews, but also other races, and they conducted mass sterilization of people they considered inferior. There were very strict marriage laws, so if you were a German, you couldn't marry a Jew, for example. But then near the end of the war, in the middle of the war, no, towards the end, sorry, when it became clear that Germany might lose, they conducted the last stage, which is the one you're most familiar with, which is that you had to kill the Jews. Originally, their plan was just to get rid of them and keep them out. That was their original plan. But then, as you know, they killed almost 6 million people. But it wasn't just Jews. They also killed homosexuals, gypsies, and other people they considered undesirable. So, of course, that's the blackest example in history you could possibly name. So try and link that with something you want to make look bad is a strategy that many people find irresistible. So trying to connect Darwin to this appeals to a lot of people. But I've always just scratched my head at these cases. To me, I find it completely bonkers. There's just no connection at all. You might as well say that Shakespeare caused Hitler, because Hitler read Shakespeare. He didn't read Darwin. But it is all too easy when there are superficial resemblances between, say, what Hitler said, that the superior race should succeed, the superior individuals, the strong, and so on. There are some superficial resemblances between that and Darwin, but they are not based on any direct connection with Hitler reading Darwin or even reading a book that was about Darwin. Because Darwin and his views by the end of the 19th century become not only widely disseminated in the sense that there were lots of copies, but you already had authors who had been influenced by Darwin, who had then influenced other authors, who influenced others. And so when you get that far down the line, you're no longer talking about Darwin, you're talking about other authors, all of whom have slightly changed, slightly misunderstood, slightly misrepresented, whatever it was that it started with, because everyone's writing a book for their own purposes, making their own arguments. And this is true for every topic and every subject. And that's why we get so many historical myths that I get to bust. Okay, then this is our latest installment. This is quite an amazing place. It's called the Creation Museum in Kentucky, opened in the year 2007. They teach a very extreme version of these new American creationist doctrines, which can be called young earth creationism. So rather than just wanting to say that life didn't evolve but was created by God in a few days, they also want to say that the 6 days mentioned in the Bible are literally 6 days. The world was created in 6 days. And they accept the old interpretation, which many people associate with Usher, as you know, it doesn't originate with Usher, that the Bible's, they think the Bible shows the world is 6,000 years old. And so these people today are actually still promoting this. They're saying the world is not really, it's not old, it's only 6,000 years old, but it's created in 6 days and so forth. This museum is run by one of these churches called Answers in Genesis, and it's aimed at families and children. It's very well funded. It's very shiny and high quality exhibits and so forth. When I was on my grand Darwin Lecture Tour in 2009, I went on a 3-week lecture tour in the USA, and I spoke in Cincinnati, which is not far away from here, and my host was a most excellent paleontologist, and he said, "Would you like to go visit the Creation Museum?" I said, "Oh, yes." I definitely want to go see that, but I was wondering whether I should remove my little Darwin button from the lapel of my jacket, and it says hell and leave it on, but I don't think anybody recognized who he was. But anyway, so I was had the privilege of visiting this museum, so-called museum, and yes, they show humans with dinosaurs side by side. It's just like the Flintstones. Only, I'm so much sadder. Anyway, I walked around this museum for quite a while, in which they show, for example, their version of how things should be read and interpreted. So, for example, they claim that before Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, it's not women's fault. Eve bit a fruit, and that was forbidden, gave it to Adam, and then everything changed, and they were cast out of the Garden of Eden. That's the story. Well, according to these people, the whole world changed. Because before that, they said nothing killed anything else. Everything lived forever and was happy, and even animals like lions and dinosaurs didn't eat meat. So their big, huge teeth were for cracking coconuts, and so forth. That's what they say. And that's why you see this happy girl there with the unbelievably dangerous looking raptor right next to her. And they're just smiling at each other. This happy anyway, and then they progress, they go on to say, well, you know, and after that, everything became bloody and animals started eating each other. So, and they also try to argue that the earth is very, very young. Now, I walked around this, and I don't see why I should do this to you. I was laughing. I was pointing and laughing, holding my stomach at all these exhibits and their panels, which were unbelievably ridiculous. They said the most ridiculous things about fossils, and they even had a panel on Darwin. I've got a good picture of me pointing at their silly misrepresentations of Darwin and natural selection and so forth. But after a while, I stopped laughing because, not that it wasn't so funny, but no, and then it became actually quite upsetting because the place was packed with people. There were vans, many of them church vans, and buses coming in constantly, disgorging young people, and there were lots of children. And I stood there next to adults and pointed at these exhibits and said to the children, "You see, that's how fossils were made 6,000 years ago in the Great Flood. They say all the fossils were made at once. Great fun and so forth." And it was, this really began to bother me, and I felt it was so sad that this institution was lying to all of these gullible people who didn't know any better. And that didn't seem funny to me anymore. Although it's still fine to laugh at it, but it's it does have a darker side. So, with that in mind, let me revisit some of the things we know about the age of the Earth. But I see I'm going to run over without giving you a break. So let's have a 5-minute break.
Jordan, come on. Slick.
Gordon.
Oh, one of you wrote me
email
message.
No, you buy car, I said no. Well, maybe some. Eh, who are you?
Where is it?
Come on, say hello to Laura, she's outside.
Shall we?
Are you serious?
We'll finally meet Laura then.
So. Not on that.
Yeah, really see. Not bad.
You think you late for him and know how?
What's the right now?
This. You got MNO presentation today. What a joke.
101 ah.
Yeah. 1000 in the first mod. Really the joke of the joke. Level 1000 mod. Joke mod. A bit of a small premium one, but I don't think it's overseas.
It's 130 for 2 days.
Yeah.
Then
oh, shit, it's not him. But why? Kim Jo Lim. Ma Yang.
Kidding.
I thought you just heard it.
So what?
Yeah. You fall asleep. Oh, it's an email announcement.
What
are we digging through? Huh? They probably email you all soon, enough, maybe like 4, 5, 6.
Whatever. Anyway, look at this.
I saw it, I saw it.
Law school, man, Chinese, what the heck?
Julian.
Yeah,
this thing,
they
were
here. No,
Julian was a senior.
Julian, you bring your. Oh, I played with Julian before. He holding a
gong jiao, you have to shut up. I thought you played
with Julian. He's my ugly senior. Then we got passed as a person. Then he came in and I partnered him. Then everything we got for him. Gong jiao! Then I was like, what the heck, Mr. Ronnie?
We all do it.
It was like weirdest.
I seldom win the points.
Huh?
Yeah, last time we got gong jiao.
Why is it gong jiao? It sounds like rooster calling. It's like a gong jiao. Cat high. By the way, do you see SC beat cat high in the spelling bee competition?
The spelling bee competition?
Primary school. Hey, they can, the people girl can spell this word called Glockenspiel, and I have no idea what that word even means.
It's on TV.
I saw it on Straits Times. I was googling someone there. I found something.
What's this?
Oh, stupid cyclist. Giving a bad name.
Why you not cycle?
Go ahead.
Bye. All the best.
Enjoy the remainder.
I don't understand what he's talking about. The before submissions, then our we got 20 people. Means the other school are 6-6. Or if you missing one.
Now we got the
SU. Oh no, like SUTD, I forgot it. Got four. Really, really.
You can write them off.
Holy shit, damn bad.
Okay, now.
SUTD or business school, I mean.
Thought that are out there nowadays that are strongly opposed to evolutionary engineering. Or I should say,
why not
what
for
they
SUTD?
Imagine evolution to be. Because when you read their writings, their picture of what they say evolution is so different from what biologists would say. So the school of thought behind this creation museum with its exhibits of people riding on dinosaurs and building Noah's Ark and putting dinosaurs, by the way, in Noah's Ark and all the rest of it, and trying to argue that the entire fossil record, the entire geological record is all manufactured in 40 days. But so please go to chapter 1. And yeah, it's extraordinary. Because as you will all know, the complexity of the Earth's history and its really, really old age, its extremely ancient depth of time, was discovered by religious geologists, Christian geologists, 300 years ago. You all know this now. These people behind this museum and others like them. They don't know this. They just don't like modern science, and they feel that it is dangerous for their ideas or for their faith, and so they're trying to construct a sort of safety blanket around their views so that they can exist in a sort of cozy greenhouse amidst unpalatable or incompatible views of the world that are all around these people. And so this leads them to make extraordinarily crazy claims and other things, and to ignore unbelievable kinds of evidence. So for example, we saw how the early geologists discovered that there had been many, 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 many eras in Earth's history. And I didn't go into very much detail about what they can see in this. So for example, Cuvier in the Paris Basin had found that there had been inundations of the sea, and there had been times when there were sea creatures living there. And then there was a layer above that where it was dry land, and there were land plants and animal bones. And there was another layer, and then maybe there was the sea was back, and then there was a land plant again, and so on. And he, although he did not believe Cuvier, still accept the literal truth of biblical blood to be made of. But people around that time were the last people in the scientific community dealt with those topics, take the stories literally true, and began to interpret them as being, well, perhaps they had that oracle meeting with some other things. For example, there's a story in the Bible about how one character stops the sun in the sky in order to make the day longer. And what was people by the 19th century, ever since Newton, would have said, well, obviously that can't literally be true because the sun is moving around us. We're moving around the sun. So it must be, perhaps interpret that one in a more figurative way or something like that. That's what they would have said. And that had been going on for a very long time. But the extreme views that we have circulating around us today are really jumping way back. And so the people who claim that geology, the rocks of the earth, and so forth, all the mountains and everything were formed in a great flood, are worse than 300 years out of date. We could be able to laugh at anyone who tried to make a claim like that, because it was impossible to uphold while actually investigating the substance of the earth. So, the very many different layers that we have in the Earth's history, in the rocks before us, as well as their fossil content, were the first kind of evidence to show the world was really old. And it's much better understood now than it was 300 years ago, or according to 200 or 150. It's extremely well understood now. As indeed we now know about seafloor spreading and plate tectonics and so forth. By the way, I told you in that lecture about plate tectonics that the continents are moving about the same speed that your fingernails grow. I don't think I mentioned that it's can actually be measured with laser beams and so forth. You can actually see that the continents are moving at this slow rate. Then of course there's a completely different kind of evidence, totally different. Radioactivity. I showed you a couple of video clips on radiometric dating in an earlier lecture, which allow scientists to date how old the rock is. So we know from having dated lots of rocks on the Earth very closely that a small gap there are how old the Earth is. And also the moon. Have you worked with the moon? Unless you believe that now. That was a hoax. The moon rocks were also dated in the same way. But by the way, the moon coast, that's a good example. Right. Lots of people out there, millions of people apparently, think that people didn't go to the moon and it's all a hoax. There's actually a couple of good movies on this, if you like conspiracy films, and it was all fake and staged. In one of the movies, the rocket that's supposedly bringing them back to Earth, and they're actually in a movie studio, the rocket burns up. The government has to kill all the astronauts, otherwise people might find out that it's faked. Anyway, so people who are sympathetic to the idea that the government is lying to us, things like that, people who are sympathetic to conspiracies, are usually more open to accepting things like this. The evidence they use is things like they investigate photographs very, very carefully. The shadows don't look right, or something like that. And then they take that and go to the extraordinary conclusion that the entire episode was fake. And yet there were hundreds of thousands of people who worked on that project over 20 years, building rockets, shooting them out there, and talking all the way. No, there's no such thing as a conspiracy that could involve hundreds of thousands of people who never black and go to get their name in these papers. It's impossible, right? That's a daydream. Secondly, what a lot of people don't know is that the Russians got to the moon first. Just like the Russians were the first to launch an artificial satellite, certainly, they also got to the moon first, but not with a human being, or indeed anything. They just fired a fired a rocket thing, and it emitted a beep. Off because the rocket crashed. That's pretty low tech. But it proved we hit the moon. We were the Russians could say we were the first human beings to touch the moon. That's a big deal. And of course their enemies or rivals or whatever. The Americans would have loved if they could say, no, they didn't, they faked it. Right? They couldn't because they tracked the radio signal. So when the Americans went to the moon, don't you think they're great rivals, the Russians? Would have loved to say, no, they're faking it, and here's the proof. No, because not only did they bring back rocks and so forth, but you could track them all the way there and all the way back from their radio field. There's nothing that could be hidden, unless you think they sent robots there, which I guess didn't exist in the 1960s. Anyway, so these fringe beliefs, the point I'm making is, seem extremely convincing to many people. And there's always a large body of literature that backs up, or apparently backs up, their views. And so it's the same with the moon hoax, moon landing hoax. And people, there's a huge literature out there. Should there loads of websites on this if you want to check any of them out. So some people believe very strongly in things, despite the fact that the case or the things they believe may be regarded by everyone else as absurd. How do we deal with this? I don't know, right? We will never all agree. Okay, now they find it evidence. So we've looked at the rocks of the Earth and the many layers of what they show. Then, of course, there's the radioactivity, which you can't really deny radioactivity. Let's see, we may fall into that radioactivity. And then there are some actual living organisms that are themselves apparently older than 6,000 years. So this old Tycho, a Norway spruce in between, is supposed to be almost 10,000 years old. And then there's King Clone, I love that. King Clone, the creosote bush in the Mojave Desert in the USA, estimated at 11,700 years old. These bushes then grow by flooding themselves with the rain. They do so in a ring. The ring just keeps growing and getting bigger. But it's the same individual. Then there's, of course, yet another kind of completely separate evidence, which is called dendrochronology. Dendro, I think that means, well, something about trees. But anyway, tree ring dating is when the rings inside the growth rings, which develop one per year in the growing season, especially in temperate areas where there's a one-year growing cycle and the trees don't grow in the cold winter. These rings vary in such a way that it's possible to reconstruct the weather patterns at the time the trees grew. So let's say you have a tree that we cut down today, and we know from historical records that it was planted in the front of this building 100 years ago. And inside that tree, we'd have 100 rings that would show us what the weather was like. Well, let's say we cut down another tree, and that tree was, say, also 100 years old, but it was only 50 when the other one was planted. So then you would have an overlap of the layers, right? So you would be able to calibrate where those, the rings of the older tree belonged from the younger one. And then you could go back in time by doing the same thing and stacking these layers on and on. And so scientists have done this, and as you can see from the quote there, we now have, for the Northern Hemisphere, a complete chronology of the weather from tree rings going back almost 14,000 years. And then the Ice Age gets in the way, because they killed a lot of trees. Another completely separate kind of evidence, really, are stalactites, stalagmites, and flows of stones and other structures that are seen in caves, which we know grow extremely slowly, usually from water is seeping through the roof of the cave, which has some solid minerals in it, and these are very, very tiny amounts deposited from each drop of water that flows down the surface of the stalactite. And these also can be cut off and have rings in them, but not annual ones like a tree. Anyway, so these structures are also tens of thousands of years old. And indeed, the caves that they are in took thousands and, in many cases, millions of years to erode. For example, some of these caves are in stone that are not soluble in fresh water. So you can't say that blood, wash them out. You need impurities in the water, like acidity or something like that. And then there's one that you should be familiar with, coral reefs and atolls. Remember, the corals only grow in a very narrow band of sunlit water at the top. And they can only grow a few millimeters per year. As we now know from the study that was done after the fall, some of these reefs are over a mile deep. And that coral rock that goes down to the seabed is also heavily compacted. It's not the fresh, springy little stuff that's growing at the top, so it's not very dense. Been crushed down by countless tons of coral growth above them. So the age of those is very hard to guess, but again, it's on the order of millions of years. And there are many submerged coral atolls in the world, coral reefs and atolls that drowned that sea level rose too much, killed them all. And so now, and the structure kept sinking, but they're now underwater. So that the Galapagos are possibly islands like this. The Galapagos Islands are formed over what is called a hotspot from deep in the Earth's surface. That's why volcanoes are erupting in that little area of the Pacific Ocean. And there's several islands there. And indeed, if you look at a map, the islands are slightly strung out along one axis. And that's because the plate, the surface of the Earth, around the world, is slightly moving in this direction over the hotspot, which is underneath. So the hotspot is trying to push lava up, and the plate is gradually moving. So the islands are gradually moving, and the new ones are being deposited at the end. And the ones furthest away are the oldest, and they are the most eroded. And because they're not growing anymore, there's no more lava, there are no more eruptions. And it turns out there are even extinct islands. There are Galapagos islands that are gone, that are further to the north. So some scientists believe that some of the creatures that we see in the Galapagos Islands didn't go, as Darwin concluded, go from South America to those islands and be marooned there for millions of years. They may have gone to these original islands and been marooned there for millions of years, and then somehow accidentally got transferred to the islands nearby before those islands submerged and are gone. Not bad, but he grew it into little dimples. Anyway, so yes, that's another very interesting way of seeing that the Earth is indeed very old, because coral grows very slowly, and coral reefs and atolls are gigantic structures, bigger than almost all mountains on Earth in terms of their height, because the sea is very, very deep, and those parts have been subsiding so long, and the coral has been growing for so long. Another one, this one's great, ice core drilling. Especially in Antarctica, where the ice is pretty old and it's been accumulating for a very long time. So they drill through the ice and get these cores with a hollow drill, and then they're able to look at the weather patterns through the past. They can also find traces of atmospheric gas, see how the atmosphere changed over time. So this is all really hot stuff nowadays with climate change and so forth. But anyway, with these ice cores, we have 1.5 million years of unbroken records. Exactly. That long from the ice. Okay, another completely unrelated kind of evidence. The speed of light. We can see the oldest star in the sky is 13.2 billion years old. Astronomers can tell the difference between, can tell the distance between objects in the night sky and so forth, based on the speed of light and Newtonian mechanics and so forth. Well, if the world is only 6,000 years old, we shouldn't be able to see any stars, unless they're less than 6,000 light years old. How did these critics get out of that? They're trying to say that the speed of light changes. Come on. It doesn't. Okay, so yet another one. The microwave background radiation, which has been discovered, which is apparently the leftover buzzing noise from the so-called Big Bang, allows us to estimate that the age of the universe is about 13 billion years old. Pretty old. The Earth, remember, is reckoned to be 4.5 billion years old. And the moon is about the same. Right? So, when you look at these types of evidence that I've just shown you here, okay, which are from different types of things, and what they show us about the age of the Earth converges. We have different kinds of evidence, and they converge on the same, or agree on something. This is very strong. It's so strong that we just accept that as that is absolutely true. That's like as far as we can ever be determined. Right? No one, I was about to say no one argues that the Earth is not flat, but actually no, there are some people would argue that Earth is flat. Even till today, there is a Flat Earth Society, I think it's in the UK, I'm afraid to say. They're president of the Flat Earth Society. In fact, when the astronauts went to the moon, some of these people were interviewed. And they said, the journalist said, haha, well, what do you say now? There are people on the moon looking at us and they'd see the Earth as well. And he said, spooky, I don't understand what it means. The man said, yes, isn't it interesting that even from that distance, Earth still looks like a globe? Can anybody explain that to me? I don't get it. In other words, the flat Earth person believes so completely that the world is flat, and it is just a mistaken appearance that has fooled the whole scientific community for 2,000 years that the world is round, but it's not, it just looks at it. Right? And then people believe that. Now, we could do the same kind of thing today. We could show them all kinds of converging evidence from different types that they're not the same kind of thing. If you showed someone like that, I guarantee what will happen. If you went to the president of the Flat Earth Society, there's nothing you can say to convince him. Nothing. It's similar with me and my Wallace fan critics, who are making my life living hell, but really. These people believe absolutely Wallace was cheated by rich Mr. Darwin and all his cronies and so forth, they believe it like their religion. And there's nothing I can do to convince them that, look, this is a legendary view that evolved only in the 1960s and 70s onwards. And here's my evidence. I challenge and reject every single piece. That's just the way it is. So sometimes you have to be prepared not to argue with someone because everyone's just going to get angry and upset. And nobody's going to change their mind. Sometimes it's better to say, okay, whatever. But that's if you're talking to the president of the Flat Earth Society. Right? You know you can't convince it, but it's not just a private conversation. If there are other people listening, let's say the public debate, for example, media interview, or blog, you're having a blog or something like that. If other people are listening and reading, those people that you should be concerned about, the ones who are, say, sitting on the fence, the ones who are undecided, those are the people that you can reach. That's the perspective I take when I talk about issues like this. I don't generally talk about Christians and public venues. Because there's plenty of people doing it, but they can do their thing, that's not my thing. But when it comes to the Wallace bags, I am firing back. I've blasted some pretty heated long posts actually. Anyway, so what we have here is overlapping or converging different kinds of evidence of many different types. And this doesn't necessarily reflect the history of the subject. The history of the subject is a different one. So, as a historian, what you often hear me emphasizing is when a particular view came into being, or where it came from. What is its origin? Because sometimes that is a very good way of both better understanding what something is, but also a very good way of refuting it. So, when I argue that no one said Darwin's theory was a secret until the 1950s or 1960s. So that means Darwin and everyone who never knew him, who never said that. I think that matters to knowing the truth. Was it a secret or not? Well, look, it's actually quite a new view by people who never met any of the principles involved. Who maybe were not so familiar with the original sources, who might have been mistaken. Or many of these views about Wallace, for example, that it was improper to publish his paper without even knowing about it. That was an opinion put forward by one writer in 1968. It is now repeated by almost every writer as simply a fact. Now, I think it means something. If you show, look, this view comes from this person and was put forward as a guess by someone who was talking about it.
No.
Probably two, the most commonly known fact about all of them, probably the common known fact. So that's why I stress so much the history of geology and paleontology being one of gradual discovery by religious scientists. It's the truth. And I think in today's context, when people are unaware of it, they've forgotten it, it matters. Because people like the Creation Museum organization, they think that science is some kind of a conspiracy, like moon landing conspiracy, that scientists are all in on it together, and they're trying to push some sort of secular or atheistical agenda, and that they are intentionally refusing to admit the truth because it's a conspiracy, therefore they're all in on it together. Well, but where does the view come from? Say, for example, the age of the Earth. Was it made up by a bunch of atheist scientists? Well, in this particular case, no, it wasn't. We know that it was a view that comes from very pious Christian scientists in the early days of theology. So the saints they would suggest that there is not that. So, anyway, all these overlapping different kinds of evidence, so many different kinds. All converge on what is accepted as the very old Earth. Now, it used to be that people could talk about these modern American creationist movements, and particularly in Europe, where everyone laughs at the Americans as being ridiculous. God, roll our eyes, oh my God, only Americans can do stuff like that. Only Americans can do such crazy things. People used to say that. That's not true anymore, because these movements have been spreading around the world. They've even supplied their textbooks and other reading materials to other organizations around the world, in Europe, in Denmark, for example, in the UK, in Turkey, where there is a very outspoken critique of evolution there, who's published something like, I can't remember, it's phenomenal, like 50 books, all with his name on the cover. But they are, in fact, translated American creationist booklets, which you put his name on, he's rich, he can do that. But they're not written by him. He just replaced the word God with Allah. But it's the same doctrine that's been written by the American creationist groups. And there's same groups are in Singapore. So that's why my last two slides are showing this. This is some materials that were shared with me by a biologist colleague here at the US. I don't exactly know the origin of these, but just look at the picture on the right. So what do you see on the top? It's two NUS graduates about to make more. I think that's supposed to be Adam and Eve, God and Eve, right? So this is creation, and then it's represented as if it was an alternative, as if there were two options that have been debated. Evolution with this silly caricature at the bottom, which of course all of you will roll your eyes at for the rest of your life, saying, oh, that's a ridiculous caricature of evolution, right? Yes, good enough, thank you. I forgot to say, this is one of the most successful strategies that came up in these court cases in America was to, just to get any distance at all, was to argue that one has to teach the controversy in public schools. In other words, we need to tell school children that there's a debate about this, about evolution versus creation. And this has become very widespread. Even American presidents have repeated this phrase because it's just been repeated so many times. And it sounds like fair play, right? It sounds so fair. Well, come on, both sides need to be heard. Right? That sounds fair. Who can object to that? The problem is, of course, that this is a made-up dichotomy in which by the creationists saying that there's two sides here, and we're one. They're vastly exaggerating their role in the world. If scientific education is supposed to be giving you an overview of what's going on in scientific in and with an overview of the scientific literature, there's no creationism in it at all. It's not big. So what should become in science classrooms should be an abridgment of what's in that vast mountain of scientific literature. Not something that's not in it at all. But this argument is very successful. It wins a lot of people. But there is no scientific debate. The scientific community isn't debating whether or not evolution happens. Nobody debates that. Nobody has since the 1870s. But that part, most of you are not aware of. They will just say that it's not debated at all. They're not really aware of how long that's been true. This cover is a pictorial way of representing that idea that there's one versus the other. It's not fair to only mention one and not the other. That's the argument that they make. On the left is read that and see if you think it is an accurate representation of evolution by natural selection. I hope you will see the flaws in it. And most shockingly of all, at St. Andrew's Cathedral, in the center of the oldest part of Singapore, someone saw these big billboards in the glass welcoming area on the street, where there are these big signs attacking evolution. This is weird, because it's an Anglican cathedral. The Church of England, the Anglican Church, has no problem at all with evolution. In fact, I don't think there are any creationists at all in the Church of England. I mean, they're just totally unheard of. Why this particular church in Singapore is so outspoken and so anti-evolution is weird. I don't understand why it is. But anyway, so there you go. Right there. See the block of text? The paragraph of text about the middle of the image. Right there, with an exclamation point at the end. The theory of evolution is false! Right? Even science has discovered that human beings are not descended from apes, and on and on and on. And then there's some quotations from the Bible and so forth. Right. I don't understand. Why does the church want me to attack science? There's no scientists out there banging on the walls of their church. I don't get it. It's strangely antagonistic. Anyway, and then there's this one. Check it out. Well, St. Andrew's Cathedral Welcome Center, right there. Are they making a monkey out of you? And you can see a nice Singaporean man in a suit gradually turning into, well, they've got that wrong, of course, haven't they? Because a chimpanzee is not a monkey. It's an ape. Chimpanzees are apes. Anyway. These direct attacks, claiming, making the most extraordinary claims, such as, that it's false, that scientists know it is, and they're just covering it up and so forth. That's a conspiracy theory thinking. Which is unrealistic, and it's idealistic. Here's how you know that conspiracies like that cannot be true. Because everyone is not on the same side. The reason you can trust science most of the time, nothing perfect, but most of the time, is because, not because if they're all on the same team, they're all pulling the same way. No way. Because they're selfish. Because every scientist is a human being with their own ambitions, their own ego, and no one would resist, for the sake of the team, to withhold some big discovery that would make them immensely famous and rich overnight by being able to prove the Earth was young or evolution was false or like that. They'd be megastars instantly. Who could resist that? Nobody. Nobody can do that. If you could disprove something big in science, you would. And then you would get lots of credit and fame for having started some new revolution in scientific thinking. they're all trying to do that, but they can't because it's really tough. And because people all around them are not making that many mistakes, so it's hard to revolutionize an area or to overturn something completely. So the idea that everyone's on the same side is, you know, that's the way that it might seem from the outside looking in. Oh, all those scientists are all the same. Got a whole bunch of atheists on the nose in there against religion. So they're not. Lots of them are religious too. So have a think of that. Scientists are. That's my argument. You can quote me on that one. You can trust science because scientists are selfish. That's my quote. Okay. So, the growth of these evangelical churches, you know, they have a lot. I've only talked about the science relevant part of them, and this isn't a course about comparative religions, so I'm not going to go into any more detail about it. I'm just talking about the part where science is being either attacked. I don't think that's the wrong word for this, right? I mean, attacking part of science here. Making other claims about science, like the age of the Earth or astronomy or radioactivity or whatever it is that contradict scientific claims. I think it's the responsibility of everyone, particularly people who have a university education, be able to assess whatever claims and arguments you come across in life, in whatever area.
Your best friend.
And to be able to ask yourselves always, who's saying this? Who's making that claim? Who wrote that sign? I don't know, but it's apparently somebody connected to that church. Or maybe they copied it from another church. But anyway, you know, right? Is this an accurate source of scientific information? Many of these American creationists try to flaunt academic credentials in order to make themselves sound more authoritative. So they almost, any of them that ever get a PhD, always put that on the cover of their books. Smith, PhD. My book against the
English. Like, I don't know he's doing, like, preaching to me.
Yeah.
But their PhD is never biology.
What is that? His views, eh? It's not like legit
views.
He can finish by 50-50 now.
Who are you? Are you a historian? You have any degrees?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Have you seen Laura before?
Sorry?
Have you seen Laura?
Query about who the
source is. Outside.
What is their background?
He's half-toying and not coming for
the
lecture.
Why are they making this extraordinary thing? Now, this part I think leads to a dead end.
Oh my god, just end now, please.
So why does those people in the Creation Museum, why are they attacking evolution? Because they think it contradicts their religion. Right? So if you're an innocent bystander, and you were listening to these, say, biologists and the Creation Museum person debating each other, you would think, well, a guy from the Creation Museum sounds biased because he's the one who said that evolutionary, he's the one who said that scientific view because it contradicts his religion. But then you might say the same thing about the scientists. Oh, well, he's not going to accept what the creationist says. Because it will contradict his scientific views.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of left in the dead end. There's no magic formula to get out of this.
Classmate last time, but not for many of these.
No, but they seriously cut
these basic rules, how to recognize what
I think so.
So, for a future lecture, I would be grateful
they are together.
If you could contact me with, don't expect a reply, please, I can't write 5 emails to 500 of you, but do get in touch and send me any significant or powerful, convincing arguments against evolution or against the Earth being old or anything like that. And then I will discuss these in the future lecture. Because I know a lot of you have questions, and I'd be happy to discuss the answers. So, for example, the common ones, well, if we evolved from monkeys, why are there still monkeys? I did explain that. I used the analogy of the English language, right? Not a little bigger space. send me those, and